Today, we're going to make this procedural old wood material, as requested by one of my viewers. To start, drag up this timeline here, and then I can just left click the clock and just change it to shader editor. Now, of course, we need an object to add our old wood material to, so I'm just going to press shift A, then under mesh, I'm just going to choose UV sphere. If you want to make this a bit more higher res, you can. I'm just going to duplicate these by 2, so I can just type in 64 and 32, and then I'm just going to right click and choose shade smooth, and that's going to give us a nice smooth ball. When I've got this object selected, you'll see this plus new appears here. And if I left click this material properties here, you can see there's a plus new here as well. These two menus are linked. They're just two ways of representing the same information pretty much. So I'll just press plus new in here, and that's going to add us a new material. And I'm going to left click material.001 and just call it old wood. Right now though, if I was to try and change this color, you can see no change has been made in the viewport. And that's because we need to change from solid mode into material preview. Now we can see the change has been made. To start off our old wood material, I'm going to create a simple base. So to do that, I'm going to press shift A, and I'm going to use one of my procedural textures called the noise texture. I'm then going to press shift A, and then under input, I'm going to choose texture coordinate. And then I'm just going to use this object and plug that into the vector. Then I'll plug my factor into the surface so we can preview what this looks like. You can see it's created this texture here on our object. And what this object texture coordinate does is it distributes the texture onto the object evenly. This works with the noise texture since it's a 3D texture. But you'll notice if it was a 2D texture, like an image texture used from your computer, you'll notice how it looks stretched like that. That's why if you try to use 2D image textures with the object coordinate, you sometimes get some issues. I'm going to change it back to 3D, and I'll maybe change my scale to something much smaller, like maybe 1.9. And I'm going to press shift A, and I'm going to need a node, which is going to allow us to adjust our noise texture, but only up and down, to create a kind of grain effect. Now, the node we'll need is called the mapping node. So I'll press shift A, and then under vector, I'm just going to choose mapping. You can also search for any of these nodes if that's easier. I'll plug that in between here. And right now, nothing's changed, but essentially what this node is going to allow us to do is make some edits. So I'll increase my Z scale. I found a number of 15, worked well. And now you can see we've got some grains that look like wood grains. For now, I'm going to go ahead and plug this factor into the base color of our principal BSDF, and then plug this principal BSDF into the surface. You'll see that our color looks a lot more shaded now, and that's because it's in this green node here, which is a shader. And what shaders do is take information such as color information and other types of information, such as reflective information, which is what roughness is, and uses that to calculate how our material will look on our object. Shaders are essential for getting realistic looks. Now, this adds some color to our base before we add any more details. So I'll press shift A, and then under converter, I'm going to choose color ramp. Color ramp is a node which pretty much allows us to edit the colors of the noise texture. I'm going to plug this in between here, and that will automatically connect things up. You'll see that we've got two notches here, and when I click this black one, there's a black bar here. If I left click the white one, a white bar appears. The white one will represent all of these lighter colors on this texture, whereas the black bar here will represent the darker areas of our texture. So if I wanted to make the darker areas green and the brighter areas pink, then I would just need to change the white color to pink and the black color to green. For us, I want the darker color to be a kind of dark brown, and I want the white color to be a kind of desaturated light peach color, since this is quite an old wood and won't have a lot of color in it. I'll left click my black notch here, and I'm just going to use this bar here to make it a little bit brighter, and then I'm going to make a nice dark color here. You won't see any immediate changes, as you'll notice things more once we edit the white color as well. As right now, if you want to get the exact same color as me, you can use this hex number here. I'll then left click the white notch, left click the white bar, and I'm going to create a more desaturated kind of brown color. If you want to get the exact same color as me, this is the hex number I used. So the first thing I'll do is make my setup a little bit more organized, since there's going to be a lot of nodes here and it's going to be hard to understand what is doing what. So I'm just going to left click and drag, box select all of these nodes, then I'll press Control and then J, and that's going to create a nice handy box around it. I can then left click the box here, and if I press N, you'll notice this side panel will open or close. And under node here, there's an option called label, and that'll allow me to name what this is called. So I'm just going to call this base wood, and now you can see it's updated here as well, so we can keep track of what's what. You can even left click this checkbox here to give it a color. For the cracks, I'm going to use another noise texture, so I'll press shift A, and then under texture, I'm going to choose noise texture. If you have the node wrangler, you can just press control T to add our mapping node and our texture coordinate, but for us, I'm just going to add it manually, so I'll press shift A, and then under input, I'll choose texture coordinate, and then I'll press shift A again, and then under vector, I'm going to choose mapping. I'll plug my object into vector again, and vector back into the vector this noise texture, and to preview what this is looking like, I'm going to plug the factor into the surface temporarily. I'm going to give this a scale of about 1.7, since I don't have too many cracks. You notice when I decrease the scale of the noise texture, the texture will appear smaller on the object. So you can think of it as increasing the scale as making more noise rather than increasing the size of the noise. For the mapping node here, I'm going to change this Z scale again to push down the noise texture to create some cracks, and I'm going to go for something like 17.7, which I found worked for me. Left click and box like these nodes, and then left click and drag them along, and I'm going to press press Shift A, and I'm going to choose Converter and then Color Ramp again. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to left click and drag some of these notches to increase the contrast between white and black. This is important because we're going to use it with a bump node, and pretty much with this bump node, the areas that are black are going to be indentations, and the areas that are white are going to be sticking out. So since cracks go inward, we want the black areas to be cracks. But if we leave it at the default, the cracks are going to be too subtle. I want to create nice high contrast cracks. So I'll move my position to around here for the black notch, and I'll left click and select the white notch, and I'll just pull it closer. And I'm also going to change this from linear to ease. And now we've got some, these black areas are going to become our cracks. We're also going to use this color ramp here as a mask, which will allow us to mix two forms of color together. I'll explain this a little bit later though. So I'll press Shift A, and then under vector, I'm going to choose bump. And then I'm just going to place that here and plug the color of this color ramp into the height. Then I can just plug my normal into the normal of this principal BSCF. Normal is pretty much the direction of the face. And when you're using a node that edits the normals, it's pretty much using texture information to simulate model detail. This will make more sense once I show you. So I'll plug normal into normal and BSCF back into surface. Now you can see we've got some really strong cracks appearing in our wood, but we don't need that level of strength. I found that a strength of 0.175 will do nicely. Now you can see we've got some nice subtle indentations to represent cracks. One problem we have though is there's not much color differentiation between the cracks and the base wood. And I want to have it so the areas that have cracks are darker. So to do that, we're going to need to do some texture mixing. But first, let's determine what our cracks are actually going to look like color-wise. So I'm going to press Shift A, and then under Converter, I'm going to choose Color Ramp again. I'm then going to plug my factor into here of this cracks noise texture, and plug my color into the surface so we can preview the changes we're making. I'm going to create a nice dark brown color, a little bit darker than the one we used for the base wood for our darkest point of the cracks. If you want to get the exact same color as me, you can use this hex number here and just type it in. Then I'll left click the white notch, and I'm going to give this a little bit of a lighter color. And now this is what our cracks color is looking like. So you can notice we can have a little bit of slight color variation from the base wood. This will create a nice result when we mix them together. Since we've now finished all of our cracks nodes, I'm just going to left click and box select all of these, pull them down, and I'm going to press Ctrl J to join them all into this box. Then I'll left click the box and I'll give it a label of wood cracks. Again, you can give it a color if you'd like. Now we've made our wood cracks color, we need to mix it in with our wood base color to get the crack areas to be a little bit darker. There's a few ways to do this, but the way I chose to do it was by pressing Shift A, and then under Converter, I'm going to choose Mix, and I'll just change this from Float to Color, and that's going to create this mix color note. If I plug this result into the surface, right now you can see we've got a plain white color output. That's because right now we've just got two white colors in A and B, and these are what are going to be mixed together, so that's what we'll plug our color ramps into. And then we've got this thing called a factor, and this determines the mix between the two colors. For example, if I set the A color to blue, for example, you notice in the middle it's a mixture between blue and white. But if I set the factor to 0, A is going to be in complete effect, and if I set the factor to 1, B is going to be in complete effect. Right now we can leave the factor because we're going to be using a mask to control the factor. You'll notice that the factor uses a number between 0 and 1, and if you're familiar with how textures convert into numbers in Blender from my previous tutorials, you'll know that the black area will represent 0 and the white areas will represent 1. So that means when I plug this mask here into the factor, you can notice the black areas of that color ramp have now become blue, which was the area represented by 0, and the whiter areas of the texture are represented by this B input, which also happens to be white. So with that in mind, we need to think about what's going to go in where in terms of our color. So what we would do is we would put the wood cracks into A, since that's going to be the black areas, and we want the black areas to be darker. Now you can see we've got some dark brown color there, and now I can plug my base wood back into B, and now you can see we've got some darker colors where our cracks are going to appear. And if I plug this mix color node into the base color, and then plug our shader BSDF back into surface, you can see we've now got the cracks and we've got the darker color inside the cracks. We're now going to take it up a notch by adding in some extra noise, like you'll see on some older wooden materials. So I'll press Shift A, and then I'm going to add yet another noise texture. So I'll come to texture and then choose noise, and again I'm going to add a texture core coordinate, and then I'm going to add a mapping node. Then we'll use object again, so I'll plug that into vector, and vector into the vector, and then I'm going to plug my factor into the surface just so we can preview the changes we're making. I'm going to make my noise scale a little bit bigger than the other ones I've done, but not quite as big as the default. So I'll give it to something like 4.1, which I find worked well. And I'll maybe increase my detail as well to something like 4.1. And you can see that adds a little bit more grain, especially once I turn my roughness up to something like 0.85 or something around there. And you can see this is looking a lot more unique. Do be careful with this detail and roughness though, because they do add a lot of extra performance costs, as it's literally layering loads of noise textures on top of each other. but we've used quite a small number here, so we shouldn't have too much to worry about. And then I want to change the contrast of this texture. So if you want to adjust contrast, you can just press Shift A and you can come to Converter and choose Color Ramp. Then if I plug this in between here, I can just move these notches to increase the contrast. You can see I've moved this black one quite far to about 0.422, and I'm going to left click the white one and move that one a bit closer too. And you can see I've now got a nice high contrast noisy result to use as the mask for mixing colors. This time we're going to use a much simpler method of adjusting color with just using the mask, so no extra color ramps, just another one of these mix nodes. But first, let's organize these new nodes we've made by left click and dragging to box select all these. Then you can press Ctrl J. I'm going to select the box and make the label of this. I'm just going to call it extra noise. I also gave it a little bit of color as well. I'll left click and box select these two nodes, and I'm just going to drag them out a little bit. You can also use G with these selected to move them a little bit easier. Keeping things nice and spacious like this really helps you get a clearer understanding of what your nodes are actually doing. I'll then press Shift A and I'm going to search for mix, and I can just choose the mix color from here to just get the mix color straight away, or you can just add a mix node and choose color like I done last time. Now, as I mentioned, we're going to be using this extra noise as the mask. Now, what a mask is pretty much the thing that gets plugged into the factor. So I'll plug this into factor, and now if you remember, I'll first plug my result into the surface. The black areas of this color ramp here are going to be represented by A, and the white areas are going to be represented by color B. This is because A is represented by a factor of 0, and 0 is represented with black, and white, which is represented with the number 1 on the factor, is associated with the B socket here. So we're actually going to be mixing two versions of the same color. So I'm just going to plug my result into A, and I'll plug my result into B as well. Since these colors are the same, you're going to notice no change. But if you remember, the black parts of this here were our noisy parts, and I want to make those a bit darker. So what we can do is add a node specifically to adjust the color of this, just to get some slight tweaks. So I'll press Shift A, and I'm just going to search for Hue Saturation Value. That's going to add a node which allows us to edit the color. I'll plug that into A, since I want to edit the black parts of the mask we just created. I'll move my nodes around as well, try to make this a bit clearer. But things can get difficult once you have a lot of nodes and wires entangling each other. One thing I might do is unplug this base color. Now, if I zoom into this node here, you can see there's three parameters. Hue, which controls the color. Saturation, which controls the intensity of the color. And Value, which controls the brightness of the color. I want to make this a bit darker, so that means I'm going to turn down this value. I found a value of about 0.7, looks quite nice here, and I'm also going to increase the saturation since darker colors tend to have a little bit more saturation. So I'll just change it to 1.1. Now, let's see what our result looks like on the shader. So I'll plug my result into base color and BSDF into surface. And now we have our old wood result starting to come together. One thing we are missing though is a little bit of roughness, as right now we're just using a base number which is a little bit bland. We could go and create a really complex roughness map for different variations for the cracks and things like that, but I'm going to keep this nice and simple and just use the output of this mix color and turn it into black and white information. So I'll press Shift A, and then under Converter, I'm going to choose color ramp. I'll then plug this color into the surface so I can see what it looks like. Right now it's just plain, but I can just plug my result into the factor, and that's turned this color result into a black and white version. Now, if you remember how I was mentioning with numbers, black represents 0, so that means the darker parts of this image are going to have a roughness of 0, which is very reflective, and the brighter, whiter areas are going to be rougher when I plug this in. But I actually want this to be the opposite way around, because I actually want the darker areas, which are kind of like cracks, to be rougher and less reflective. So there's a quick way we can do this. All I need to do is left click this arrow and choose flip color. Now you can see the whiter areas are kind of like the cracks, and the darker areas, which are a little hard to see now, are going to be the more reflective areas. I'm also going to move the dark notch a little bit closer to bring in some more reflectiveness. I'm also going to adjust these colors as well, because right now this is going to be a little bit too high contrast in terms of roughness. So I'm going to left click the white notch, left click the white bar, and I'm going to make this color a little bit darker. This was the final color I ended up with, so you can copy this number if you'd like. Then I'll left click the black notch, and I'm going to make this a tiny bit brighter. Here is the final number I ended up with. Now I'll plug my BSDF back into the surface, and we can go ahead and plug this color of our color ramp into the roughness. And now when I rotate around my sphere, you can see we've got a little bit more reflection variation, which looks quite nice. Now, in order to see this material in its full glory, I'm going to quickly set up an HDRi. So I'll left click my world properties here, and I'm going to press plus new to add world lighting if you don't already have one. I'll then left click this button here to go into render preview. Right now we've just got a plain grey world background, which doesn't really show off our material. It's important to set this up because this is what our rendered image is going to look like. The mode we were in before was more just the mode for previewing previewing how your material will look like in most situations. I'll left click my world properties again, and I'm going to left click this yellow dot here, and then choose environment texture. And this is going to allow us to add a special type of texture called an HDRi to create some instant realistic lighting. You'll notice once I do that, the whole scene goes purple, and that's just because we haven't added the texture yet. To fix this, I'll just press open, and now I'm just going to come to my downloads folder where I have a few HDRis, which I downloaded from a free resource called Polyhaven. I'm not sponsored by them, but I do think their resources are quite good, so I'd recommend checking them out if you want some free textures or HDRis. HDRis can either be a .exr file or .hdr file, so if you want to find them quickly, you can just search for .exr or .hdr, depending on which one you've downloaded, to access them easily here. So I'll left click the one I want, and then just press open image, and now we can see what our material looks like for if we want to render it. Perfect, but if you want to learn more about how materials work and some of the fundamentals which I've covered in this tutorial, I highly recommend checking out my free course on texturing and material basics for beginners. It also comes with free PDF guides as well, and really breaks down some of the concepts covered in today's video. Apart from that though, I'd like to thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.